J. Four. C.
The afternoon is here, y'all. The afternoon is here. It is time to party. Nah. Combine is overrated. Pro days are overrated. XFL players are playing NFL. Cat moms in the corner. Damn.
Are you ready for it?
Oh, yeah. We ready, baby.
Are you ready for it?
Just for Clicks, guys. This is Michael Buckheiser, raw and uncut sports talk coming at you to you on the noon edition at rtfsportsnetwork.com. Also, over there on the Facebook page, Just for Clicks Facebook page, you can also find me on iTunes, iHeartRadio, Google Podcasts, Speaker, Breaker, wherever you get your podcast form, we are out there. Look for Just for Clicks. Look for the yellow penguin with the headset on. I believe. No, we are. Just for Clicks is it's awesome. Guys, we got a big show lineup for you today. We got Marcus's Fork Spree coming on the bottom half of the hour here, talking his Dallas Cowboys and Dak Prescott and Amari Cooper and the retirement of, Frederick. So, I mean, got big changes happening for the Dallas Cowboys. We got some XFL players, five now, have gone to the, or have signed deals with the NFL, I should say. But I'm going to go off on probably a little tangent on, like on that. So stay tuned for the at the quarter hour for that segment number two, but we got to get into the first topics of the day.
Trending topics.
Yes, guys, and that is the trending topics. Trending topic number one. Are the Carolina Panthers going to regret releasing Cam Newton? Are they? I'm going to tell you this. If Cam Newton is healthy, the answer to that question is yes. They are going to regret. Because by them releasing Cam Newton, they are saying we are in rebuild mode. Right? They're in rebuild mode by releasing their franchise quarterback that took him 15-1 in just, you know, what, 5 or 6 years ago. 15-1. Wrap your head around that. People tend to forget about that. I mean, granted, they didn't win the Super Bowl by any means, but that was your Cam Newton was league MVP and whatnot. But by releasing Cam Newton, you are telling that the franchise that we are in rebuild mode. By signing Teddy Bridgewater, you made a lateral move. You did not move up in the draft to get another franchise quarterback. You did not trade for a franchise quarterback. You guys could have got some value out of Cam Newton, I think. At least fifth round pick, at least. I mean, he's only, what, 30 years old? Former MVP, went 15-1. Man, that man is Superman. But by them signing Teddy Bridgewater, a lateral move, I think. I think Teddy and Cam are the same player if Cam is healthy. By them doing that, they're saying, you know what? We are happy being mediocre. Carolina Panthers are going to regret this because Cam Newton is going to get with another team. He may not be a starter off the bat. But if Cam Newton is healthy, which everybody says he is, I mean, he took basically all of last year off with that foot injury, but he still has that lingering shoulder injury. His throwing motions are weird or whatever. But we'll not worry about that. There are teams out there that could use the services of Cam Newton. You had the Denver Broncos, for example. You had the Patriots. Yes, they did sign Boyer, but he is an aging veteran. I mean, you had the Jets. You had the Chargers that need a quarterback. I mean, heck, even the San Francisco 49ers could probably use a quarterback. I mean, if you want to get downright honest with it, is Jimmy G really the answer, like, in there? I don't know. But we'll worry about that later. But the trending topic right now is Cam Newton was released, obviously. Carolina Panthers will regret this in the end. They will regret this because look at that division. Look at all those quarterbacks they have in that division right now. Now you have Tom Brady in there. Shoot. They have Matt Ryan in there. I'm trying to think of who else is in there right now. You have Drew Brees in there. I mean, you have 100 years of quarterback in your division, not counting like the ones on your team. But kind of got off track there a little bit. My bad, guys. Yes, Carolina Panthers will regret releasing Cam Newton in the end. That's just the bottom line.
Number two.
Topic number two. Carl Anthony Towns reveals that his mother is in a medically induced coma from complications of the COVID-19 virus. I'm going to play you guys the little sound bit that he has here.
During my life, you know, I think it's important that everyone understands the severity of what's happening in the world right now with this coronavirus. And I think where my life is right now could help. So I decided to do this video and, you know, just give you an update of where I'm at. So I was told early last week my parents weren't feeling well. And after a couple of days of not getting and showing any signs of improvement, I was very adamant on the first day to go to a hospital and seek further evaluation. Specifically, me and my sister, I told her she needs to get checked for corona. I talked to her before she went there, told her I loved her. Every day I always told her how much I love her. She was telling me things that I didn't want to hear, so I dismissed some things she was saying because it wasn't something I want to hear. You know, it's difficult. It's been very difficult for me and my family, to say the least. She is the head of our household. She's the boss. She's been in a medically induced coma. Since that day, I haven't talked to her, haven't been able to obviously communicate with her. I've just been getting updates on her condition. To only make this video so that people understand that the severity of this disease is real. This disease needs to not be taken lightly. Please protect your families, your loved ones, your friends, yourself. I hope my story helps. I hope my story gives you the correct information. My mother, the strongest woman I know, and I know she'll beat this. We're gonna rejoice when she does. Love you guys. I'll talk to you later.
So obviously he is very emotional, urging everybody to take this seriously, and I want to urge everybody to take this seriously. This is a big deal, guys. I mean, yes, I said this before. 80% of us are not even going to feel symptoms. We might have a slight fever or like a tickle in our throat. 80% of us will be okay. 10% of us will get sick. We'll feel bad, but we'll recover. The other 10% are going to die. That's just the way it is. There are going to be people that are going to die from this, and that 10%, hopefully it's not you, it's not anybody that you know, any loved ones, you know. I mean, I don't ever wish ill will on anybody, but facts are that somebody is going to die from this, and 10% of the people are probably going to die. That get this. Because of the underlying causes, whatever, I don't want to get into political nonsense about this, but this is real, okay? I want people to take precautions. You know, be smart. If people are telling you to stay home, stay home. My job right now is making me go into work because I am an essential employee. Awesome. I have my door shut in my office. I got the Lysol cans and the hand sanitizer ready to go. I even go as far as changing my clothes before I come. When I leave work, I take off my clothes, put them in a bag, tie them up, you know, put on a pair, like my hoodie that I'm wearing right now, and a pair of shorts, and I head home. Because I have a newborn son at home. I got a 2-year-old. I got a wife that just had a newborn son. I don't want to bring any of that crap home. I don't want to be, unfortunately, in Carl Anthony Towns' shoes. That's just the way it is. I don't want to be there. I feel for him. I feel for everybody that has been involved with this. I am a person that did not take this seriously when it first came out. I'm like, oh, it's just, it's like, I was reading into it and like, oh, it is just like the flu. Like, okay, whatever. Like, then you see just how it's so much uncertainty about this that we don't know. Can we get it again? Is it like chickenpox? Once you get it, you're like, you're fine. If you get it again, like say you were sick the first time and you get it again and you, is it going to be worse? You know, like there's so much uncertainty and it sucks. Yes, it sucks. It sucks being quarantined at home. Yes, it sucks not having a job. But thank you for listening to me. I'm giving it to you guys for free. Just subscribe, follow me on iTunes, iHeartRadio, Google Podcasts, etc. Like me on Facebook. Jeez, that's all I'm asking. It's free. But guys, take this COVID-19 thing seriously. You are seeing it hit in the NBA really hard. And this is the first, you know, I guess celebrity that's getting really sick from it. It's just a matter of time before more people start coming out. And unfortunately, it sucks. So, moving on. Next trending topic. Minnesota Vikings signed Tejay Sharp to a deal. 25 receptions to 329 yards last season. Career high, 4 touchdowns with the Tennessee Titans. Is this a big deal, no deal for the Minnesota Vikings? I mean, obviously it's a big deal if it's on trending topics, right? I mean, they let it go Stephon Diggs, who they traded to the Buffalo Bills earlier last week, I should say, for some draft picks. I believe it was 4 draft picks. And then they got they still have Adam Thielen there. That's a pretty good receiver. So, yes, this is a great signing for the Minnesota Vikings. Sucks for the Tennessee Titans fans. You guys had something going on there. You lost an old lineman. Now you're losing receivers. Probably going to lose some defensive players that like as well. Unfortunately, that sucks. But Tajon Sharp, formerly from the Tennessee Titans, has signed a deal with the Minnesota Vikings. I believe it was just a 1-year deal, which is kind of surprising to me. But obviously, I think they'll get him once he starts producing like I think he will for the Minnesota Vikings. Good things are going to come from them. So,
number 4.
Trending topic number 4. I'm going to get into some political stuff here, some transgender stuff. If you guys don't know what transgender is, it's a man thinks he's a woman or a woman thinks he's a man and sexual changes and whatnot. I'm not going to get too deep into that. I'm going to keep this on the sports aspect of things. If you remember a couple years ago, was it 2018 or 2017, the big, I'm going to use the word craze because I think this is people just following suit in the end. You can bash me all you want on Twitter at mbuck41 if you don't agree with my thoughts or opinions. But I think once one person comes out, it is more of a thing like, oh, they're doing it. I'm going to do it as well. So I think in 2017, 2018, it was a big craze to say that I'm a transgender. But I'm going to digress from that a little bit. I want to focus on the sports side of this, and I kept on reading articles, you know, back in that time, that all these women's track records were getting destroyed in the year 2017, 2018 because of transgender men. Is that the proper term, transgender man? I mean, it's transgender. It was a man saying that he was a woman competing in a woman's sport in track and field. Destroying records, winning state championships, yada yada yada. All because they're competing at a man level, and then all of a sudden their junior senior year they're a female competing at the female level. But there has now been rulings on this. This is coming from Connecticut. They are no longer allowing transgenders to compete in the opposite sport. So if you are a man, you cannot compete in a woman's sport if you say you're transgender. If you're a woman, you cannot compete, well, in a man's sport. I highly doubt they would do that. But this is mainly geared toward men. Like, you cannot say you're a transgender female and compete in female sports. Congratulations to Connecticut for being the first one to publicly put this down on paper and say, you know what, this is against the law. This is not going to work. I feel other states are going to follow through pretty quickly because this is quite ridiculous, to be honest with you. This is why this is a trending topic, just because that people just, they don't, I, I don't, I don't know what it's like to be a transgender. I'm not even going to fake it. You know, I said transgender. I am a ginger. The red beard going on. Transgender, I should say. The problem with this is that just because you are a man and you think you are a woman doesn't mean that you get to compete in women's sports. You have been a man for 16 years of your life. You have the testosterone. You have the muscle build. You have the frame. All of a man, unfortunately. You can think you are a woman. You can feel that you are a woman all you want, but it is wrong for you to compete in a female sport. That's just the way it is. Congratulations to the state of Connecticut to saying, you know what, the first movement, and I feel all the other people are going to fall in suit here. You know, they have to. They have to. That's just the way it is. But, guys, we're going to take a quick break. Join me on the other side of the break. We're going to talk XFL players to the NFL. Combine overrated? Question mark? Who knows? See what I say next, guys. Be right back. Just for Clicks, Michael Buckheister. Like, comment, subscribe. Follow me on iTunes, iHeartRadio, Spotify, Facebook, YouTube, and especially right here on RTFSportsNetwork.com. Be right back. Welcome back. Welcome back. Welcome back. Michael Buckheister, Just for Clicks, Raw and Uncut Sports Talk. Coming at you on the noon edition at RTFSportsNetwork.com. If you guys are listening to us on that website, consider subscribing to the Spreaker channel, giving away a $500 gift card in the month of May. All you have to do is simply following the Spreaker page. That's all you got to do. Follow the Spreaker page, and you get automatically entered into winning that moolah. Sorry for hitting the mic there. But if you guys are also, you know, been a patron of mine for a while, follow us on Facebook, name change, Just for Clicks Facebook page. Go ahead and like that page. Follow us on there as well. Also on iTunes, Spreaker, Google Podcasts, iTunes, iHeartRadio. I really like the iHeartRadio hat, by the way, guys. That is really awesome. You can listen to local radio and podcasts as well. It's really, really good things that are happening over there at iHeartRadio. But we have gone over the trending topics for the day and whatnot, but I want to get into the meat of today's show. And the meat of today's show is going to be really the XFL players that are going to the NFL. So I have the article pulled up here on my screen as my phone starts blowing up there. If you guys heard that, I apologize. Let me go ahead and shut that off there. My bad. My sister wants to talk to me. What a crazy little girl. Thinks we're like friends or something. But let me get into that. Do you guys have a family member that, like, you rarely talk to? You know, you're thousands of miles, apart, and you never, like, talk to them on the phone or text them, but you Snapchat back and forth every single day? Is that considered talking? Is Snapchatting back and forth all day, every day, is that considered talking to, like, a significant person? I'm talking, like your mom or your dad, brother, sister, wife, aunts, uncles, etc. Is that considered talking? I mean, I know this is total off topic, and the only reason why I'm bringing it up because of Snapchat, just like that's how me and my sister communicate, is through Snapchat, more or less. I mean, like, we rarely text or rarely call each other. I FaceTime her now with my newborn son and the kids and whatnot to, you know, say, hey, there's Aunt Danielle. When she comes down, you know, they know who she is. I love the technology and that aspect of things. But I want to ask you guys, hit me on the Twitter machine at mbug41, or like that Facebook page, Just for Clicks Facebook page. See the picture of my face holding up some fish, saying raw and uncut. Or you have the penguin that says Just for Clicks on it. Both pictures are there, but I digress on that. Let me know, is talking on Snapchat considered talking, like, you know, having a conversation? Is that considered talking? Is snapping pictures back and forth, is that considered talking? But moving on here. Before we got carried off on old Snapchat and talking about family members and whatnot, I want to talk about the XFL and, you know, the minimal. I mean, people say it's minimal success, but I think they had pretty good success, you know, considering that, I mean, what, they had five games, I believe it was, Yeah, because the Roughnecks were 5-5-0, so they were going to end the week 6 before the coronavirus, the COVID-19, shut down sports, period. Shut down the world. So, I mean, I say minimal sets, but I enjoyed what they were doing. I like the kickoff. I like the comeback rule. I like the 1, 2, and 3-point conversions, although it messes with my normal football mind of 7 points and whatnot. So, like, when a score is, like, I don't know, when it's, like, 17-7 or it's, like, 17-8 and it's still a one-possession game, I'm like, what are you guys talking about? This is ridiculous. But then they got the 9-point. You can get up to 9 points on a touchdown and the 3-point conversion, which is from the 10, if I remember correctly. But there have been 5 players so far from the XFL that have signed NFL deals. The first one being P.J. Walker. P.J. Washington from the Kentucky mind is my mind's on Kentucky sports right now for some reason. But P.J. Walker, quarterback from the Houston Roughnecks, signed a 2-year deal with the Carolina Panthers. This was before Cam Newton got released. I believe Teddy Bridgewater signed that same day, maybe. And I think they released Kyle Allen, or they traded Kyle Allen that same day as well. So at the time that P.J. Walker was signed to the Carolina Panthers, you had Teddy Bridgewater, you had Cam Newton, you had Will Greer still, and then, of course, P.J. Walker, him, like himself. Since then, Cam Newton has been released, and it has highly been speculated that P.J. Walker will compete for the second string position from Will Greer. I don't know about this. Like at first when, you know, P.J. Walker signed with the Carolina Panthers, I was like, well, hey, this is good. You know, XFL players going to get some exposure, second string quarterback, get some good preseason work. But now looking at it, guys, he's probably going to go into third, maybe even fourth string going into camp. And without there being camp right now or OTAs or like anything, I really question if he'll even get a roster spot. But there are other four other players that have signed deals as well. Jordan Tamu, which is the quarterback from the St. Louis Battlehawks, I believe they're 4-1. He was having a really, really good season, probably the best season out of all the players in the XFL. He was picked up by the Super Bowl champion Kansas City Chiefs, signed him to a one-year deal. Also, this comes into play. He is going to be battling for a third-string spot because the Chiefs did sign Chad Henne, I do believe, for the backup role. They brought him back to Kansas City after he left and did some other things. And came. He's been, like, on, I don't know, 6 or 7 different teams in, like, 9 years. He seems to be jumping around, like, a lot. But Jordan Tamu, I really like him. I think he would fit well in the Kansas City offense and a lot better than Chad Henne. So I really look forward to seeing if he can get that second string spot. Dietrich Nichols, DB for the Houston Roughnecks, also signed a 1-year deal with the New Orleans Saints. They announced that Tuesday. Side note here, he did play 6 games for the Arizona Cardinals in 2018 after being undrafted from South Florida. So, you know, he definitely has that NFL experience, unlike the other couple players that we have previously mentioned. Also on DB from the New York Guardians, Daron Askew Henry. Apparently, he is a cousin of the longtime New York Jets standout. They didn't say who, which is weird. Why would you say you are a cousin of a Jets standout, but never give his name, which is kind of weird. But I digress on that. But he signed a 2-year deal with the New York Giants. He was from West Virginia. I remember this guy. He was very, very, very good. The Giants needed a good stability there. But the reason why I'm bringing those names up is these are 5 names that probably would have not have ever gotten another have never gotten an NFL chance, or in Dietrich's Nichols case here, another NFL shot if it wasn't for the XFL. Guys, film does not lie. This is why I'm bringing this up right now, is because I think that the NFL needs the XFL. The XFL doesn't need the NFL. I think the NFL needs the XFL to find these diamonds in the rough, guys, because film doesn't lie. I'm going to go off on a little tangent here. You guys, bear with me, okay? I am the type of person that I think combines, 40-yard dashes, bench presses, squats are highly, highly overrated. Let me repeat that. The combine, overrated. Pro day, overrated. 225 bench press, overrated. The 300-pound squat that you do in the combine as well, overrated. The IQ test, overrated. All the background checks that they do, all that is overrated, guys. Film does not lie. I am the type of player that when the lights shined on, I kicked it on to a different level. I was a man among boys when the lights came on. During practice, I was just an average player. I was an average player during practice at best. Gave half-ass effort, didn't do drills fully, but when those lights shined on, those Saturday night lights shined on, I was a man among boys out there. Guys, film does not lie. These five players would have never gotten a chance because of, let's see here, P.J. Walker, I believe, is 5'11", if I'm not mistaken. It doesn't give Jordan Tamu's, like, stats right here off the top, like, on the article that I'm reading. But, guys, these five players would have never got the opportunity to play in the NFL if it wasn't for the XFL because of their combine scores, because of the 40-yard dash, because of their bench press, because of their IQ, whatever the red flags may have been. But guys, the film doesn't lie. When the lights turn on, the film doesn't lie. This is why I think the XFL is going to succeed. It's because of players just like these five that make it to the NFL. When the XFL was around the first time, what was it, 2004, 2005, I think it was, there were several players that made it to the NFL then. I don't have the names off the top of my head, but he hate me, that running back, made it. The quarterback, I should have looked this up. I believe the quarterback went to the Steelers, if I'm not mistaken. If you guys are listening to me on Facebook Live here, message down below and let me know if you remember some of those names. But those are two or three people that I know that made it from the XFL to the NFL, the first extent of the XFL. And also, side note, what is up with this inaugural season stuff? This is the second. This is actually the third season of the XFL. So why is it the inaugural season? But I digress on that. So the point of this segment right here, this quick little XFL segment, these five players. Congratulations to those guys to signing deals. Just because you signed a deal doesn't mean you made the team. Obviously, you still got to go through OTAs, mini camp, and whatnot, and get on the roster. I hope they all five make the roster, especially Jordan Tamu. I think he'll be a great fit in Kansas City. I could really find myself falling in love with that player in an asexual way. My man. But go Chiefs all the way. Super Bowl champs. Roll that off the tongue. Super Bowl champs, Kansas City Chiefs. But let's get back on track. The NFL needs the XFL because the NFL needs a G League. Just like the NBA needs the G League. Just like the NBA needs college. I mean, I think the NBA needs college basketball more than college basketball needs the NBA. Kind of just like the XFL, the NFL needs the XFL more than the XFL needs the NFL. Because at the end of the day, it's football. We're going to tune in. We love football. Yes, we're not going to be passionate about it like we are our NFL teams, like my Kansas City Chiefs, passionate about them. They're going to be like a Division II school that, you know, it's in your town and you happen to go to games and check them out and you root for them. That's why I think the XFL will succeed. But back to the original point here. I think the combine is overrated. Why? I'm not saying anybody can run a 4.3. But just because you run a 4.3 doesn't mean that you can catch the football. Just because you can bench press 225 pounds 45 times doesn't mean that you can block, you know, Javavion Clowney coming off the edge. Just because you got stellar footwork and cones, put on that helmet and show me what you're made of, boy. That's what it comes down to. That's what I'm trying to get to. Congratulations to the XFL, to these players for making it to the NFL. Signed deals with the NFL. 1-year deals. A couple of them were 2-year deals. Those 2-year deals, I think they'll definitely stick, be on the team like a little bit, unless you're P.J. Walker, unfortunately. But I digress on that. Guys, film does not lie. This is why the NFL needs the XFL. They need to somehow integrate the two leagues, the two organizations, make the XFL, the G League, or whatever you want to call it, the minor league system of the NFL. This is where you experiment with the rules. This is where you experiment with the time clocks and camera angles and whatnot. And then if it succeeds during that springtime from the March until June, once August, September rolls around, roll it out into the NFL. This is what the NFL needs. The NFL needs the XFL. Simple as that. Film doesn't lie. Congratulations to PJ Walker, Jordan Tamu, Dekret Nixels, Devon Ashkew Henry, and I'm missing one. PJ Walker. Congrats, guys. You made it. Mama, I made it. But join me on the other side of the break. We'll be back. Because this is Just for Clicks. Raw, uncut sports talk. NFL Combine is overrated. Pro Day is overrated. So is Lamar Jackson. How to get him in there, guys. Go Chiefs. We'll be back. And welcome back to Just for Clicks, guys. This is Michael Buckeyser. And on the line, I got a special guest, Marcus the Sports Freak, the biggest Dallas Cowboy fan you'll ever meet, the most knowledgeable one as well. Marcus, how you doing today?
Hey, pretty good, Michael. What's going on?
Living the dream, loving the rain, enjoying some sports with you, my friend. And
you ever gone outside your house yet? You can get arrested, man. Don't go outside your house. They'll pull you over and take you in.
Well, unfortunately, I am considered essential personnel to make to make the world run because I do IT work for a manufacturing place that makes foam. So apparently, the world needs their foam, man. The world needs their foam.
Yeah.
But
you get that bumper sticker. Don't pull my ass over.
Right. It is kind of funny that you said that because I live in the state of Indiana here, and they made our National Guard active, and for the first time ever, I've seen Humvees driving up and down the road. And there were a group about 15, 16 kids at the park, you know, playing, just having a good time, being kids, you know. And those Army guys walked up to them and made them all leave. So it was kind of...
Oh, yeah. It's a different animal. Even when police walk up to you, you know, some kids will disrespect the police. Like, yeah, whatever, dude, right?
Yeah.
When you see that tank coming on your butt and you see soldiers with M16s or whatever, yeah, you think a little different. Your ass better get your butt inside.
Hopefully all this blows over and we can go into normalcy here soon. But it's not going to be for a while. Hopefully football season does not get pushed back at all. I brought Marcus on today to talk football and specifically the Dallas Cowboys and their offseason moves so far. So first things first, Marcus, let's shoot the elephant in the room. Let's get it out there. Dak Prescott got franchise tagged. How do you feel about that right off the bat?
Well, look, I mean, you got all these people clamoring for, hey, sign him to this long-term deal and da-da-da. They did try already, Michael. He turned down a 3-year, $105 million deal, which would have, you know, paid him, what, $35 million a year? I think even $100 was guaranteed. It's just basically a ridiculous contract, and he turned this down. So it's nobody's fault but his that he's playing with the franchise tag. And by the way, that franchise tag is guaranteed $30.1 million. So this Dak Prescott, no one is shedding tears for Dak Prescott.
Right.
He'll be just fine. He can afford the extra value meal next year, when he goes through the drive-thru. He'll be just fine. I would do exactly what the Cowboys are doing. You don't want to sign that 3-year, $105 million deal? Okay, we're going to franchise tag your butt, and let's see how good we'll be in the same situation next year. We'll see how good you do. Hey, and if you take us to the promised land and we win the Super Bowl, okay, I'll go ahead and open up the bank for you. But until then, sir, you work on this $30 million deal after turning down $105 million of Jerry Jones's money, and let's see how well you do. Let me tell you something, a doom and gloom situation for Dak Prescott and Cowboys fans, and I don't want to see this happen. What if they go 8-8 again and Dak, you know, has some good stats, but he doesn't take us anywhere again? His value decreases. They might, you know, who knows? They could let him walk. You know, so, I mean, this is a little tricky time here. But listen, $30 million, he signed. People are talking about, oh, what is it, you know, is Dak going to play for the Cowboys next year? He signed already. They have to agree to a contract, a long-term deal before July 15th. If not, he plays for that $30 million. He signed that contract already. So he will be the Dallas Cowboys quarterback. It won't be anybody else next year, and let's go. And the irony of all this and the odd thing is nobody's been able to practice. Because Tom Brady, there, you know, he's got Howard and Goodwin and Mike Evans, and two of the, you know, I mean, three great athletes, the tight end and the two receivers. He can't go practice with them in this times that we're living in under this coronavirus stuff. So the teams that might benefit next year are the teams like that have familiarity. Dak Prescott throwing to Amari Cooper and Michael Gallup. He should know those guys by now. They shouldn't need too much practice, to know where they're going and how the receivers like the football. So this should benefit teams like the Dallas Cowboys that are throwing to familiar receivers. And that Amari Cooper signing was a big deal, so that can happen. So yeah, let's pump the brakes on the. I always hear this, oh, woe is me for Dak Prescott. Oh, he deserves this. Oh. He's playing on $30 million this year. He turned down $105 million. That's his own fault, Michael.
Yeah, I think he's going to do all right in the bank category. But yeah. I'm worried about the Cowboys' long-term future here because you did bring up Amari Cooper. He did sign a $100 million contract. I believe it was 5 years, $100 million, right. If I'm not mistaken. They've also signed Zeke to a pretty long-term deal. And then we had our center retire abruptly, yeah, at like 29 years old. So there's big holes to fill. But before we get too far into that, I want to stay on this Dak Prescott thing. And you alluded to it here a little bit. What if the Cowboys do go 8-8 again? I'm thinking in the back of my mind right now, there are some fairly good talent out there that could get that we could pick up for fairly cheap. I'm talking about Cam Newton. Talk about Jameis Winston and maybe Rosen from the Miami Dolphins. Do you think the Cowboys entertain any of these three or four quarterbacks that are still that were starters at some point, but now are either free agents or have been cut or kind of looking for a new home? Do you see the Cowboys exploring any of those options?
I don't see that, but I would if I was the GM, if I was Will McClay, if I was Stephen Jones, I'd convince Jerry Jones to look at Jameis Winston, to look at even Cam Newton, who I really don't think Cam Newton can play anymore in terms of being a dominant football player. His throwing motion, his shoulder, I think, is shot. So I probably would look Cam Newton's direction. But if he wanted to come in and say, hey, I'll back up Dak and learn you guys' system, I'd entertain it. Jameis Winston's been a turnover machine throughout his career, and everybody loves to talk about Jameis Winston, all the 30 interceptions. That's why he's not getting signed. Michael, he's not getting signed for his whole body of work. Right. He's been turnover prone since he came in the league with fumbles and interceptions. But he is a talent. There's a reason why he was the number one overall pick in the draft a few years ago. If he wants to come in and back up Dak Prescott and maybe replace Dak Prescott and cut down and on the turnovers and turn over, you know, a new leaf and try to make a career out of it, sure, I'd look at signing Jameis Winston. And I forgot who's the other guy you told me. It was Cam Newton, Jameis Winston.
Josh Rosen from Miami.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I'll be honest with you. I like Josh Rosen. I would trade my third round pick. I think that the Cowboys have like the 81st or 82nd selection overall. I'd see if Miami wants to get rid of Josh Rosen for that. Josh Rosen, listen, Josh Rosen maybe will never be a great franchise quarterback, but I will take this to the bank. He's better than Cooper Rush.
Right.
So yeah. To have Josh Rosen backing up Dak Prescott would be nice. Any of those would do wonders. Yeah. Or do they just kind of fall on their face a little bit next year and Dak Prescott finishes another eight and eight year and they let him walk and then they sign an Andy Dalton. And then with their first round pick next year, they go after a quarterback, which is all possible.
Yeah, as a passive Cowboys fan, they're my second team. Obviously, the Kansas City Chiefs are my first team that I root for week in and week out. I almost kind of want the Cowboys to kind of fall flat on their face again this year because I am tired of the Dak Prescott wanting all this money type of situation. because the Cowboys are in a must-win now situation. Because I've said it many, many times on many, many shows. Once you sign that $100 million man, you are in a must-win now situation. And you have to win with the team that you have because you can't sign anybody else. So with that being said, the $100 million man I'm referring to is Amari Cooper. They signed him to a five-year, $100 million deal. First things first, do you think he was worth that?
No, but listen, that's what the market dictates, and I hate that saying, that's what the market dictates. I wish you could pay people what they're actually worth. But listen, I think that it's a good signing in terms of, you know, you got to get Amari Cooper back, man. I mean, that's just – he's a good receiver. He was terrible on the road. We got to correct that. But he's a heck of a receiver. And his rapport with Dak Prescott, they were great together. You know, you can't sell that short, that rapport that they had together. So I think you had to get the Amari Cooper done, the deal done. I think it should have been more in that 4 years, you know, $70 million or 5 years, $80 million contract. But, you know, hey, it's not my money. And, you know, they signed him to that $100 million. I hope Amari Cooper is happy with it, motivated. I don't agree with the money, but I do agree with the signing. Yes, to answer your question.
So do you think they could have maybe got him for like cheaper, or do you think the – because of the wide receiver market that's out there, I mean, the free agent market is kind of thin, and there are several teams that needed wide receivers. Like you had the Eagles that need wide receivers. You had the Dolphins that need wide receivers. You had the Jets that need wide receivers. Do you think they had to make a splash to keep him?
I think they had to make a splash. Jerry Jones doesn't want to pay a receiver $20 million a year. I think he had to do it because Amari Cooper would walk, and you know he'd be playing with the Carolina Panthers for $100 million or the Redskins for $110 million, what was reported.
Right.
And it's kind of – and I don't agree with releasing DeAndre Hopkins of the Texans, but it was told that he wanted $20 million a year. He was going to sit out. And so Bill O'Brien told him, okay, you know
– have fun in Arizona, right?
Yeah, have fun in Arizona, which he might have fun in Arizona. And I'm not sure they're going to win, but that is going to be a fun team to watch. They'll be put on Monday Night Football now along with Tampa Bay. When was the last time you saw Arizona or Tampa Bay on Monday Night Football? They will be on this year. But right. But D-Hop signed a five-year, $81 million contract, and he had 3 years left on it, and he wanted a new contract, and Bill O'Brien sent him packing. You know, yeah, like you just mentioned, Michael, have fun in Arizona. So the market dictated Amari Cooper getting this kind of money. I don't think any receiver is worth $100 million, but I think they still had to get Amari Cooper in their program to make this Dak Amari Cooper Michael Gallup combination work.
Yeah, and just to add to your top to your point there, I don't think any player is worth $100 million because when a player takes almost a third of the salary cap every year, I mean it's kind of ridiculous. But
Michael, let me say this: the cap's going to go up now with the TV money and all that, so it's not going to be as bad in a couple of years. But you're right; it's still a lot of money.
Yeah, I think this year it raised like $10 million or $20 million. I'm not 100% sure on that. But some more breaking Cowboy news within, you know, the last 24 hours or so, five-time pro bowler Travis Frederick has officially retired from the NFL. He says he has been diagnosed with Guillain-Barré syndrome.
Guillain-Barré syndrome.
In 2018, and he just could never shake it and get healthy and get back on the field.
Right.
How big a hole is this for the Cowboys?
Well, that's a big one, and you feel really bad for the person, Travis Frederick. I mean, he was on his way to the Hall of Fame. I know it sounds crazy. He's a five-time Pro Bowler, and he was more one of the more dominant centers that we've seen in this league. This guy was a heck of a player, and he retired at 29 years old. He joins a list of, like, you know, Patrick Willis of the 49ers retiring at 29. You know, these young players, Tiki Barber, Barry Sanders, Andrew Luck, you know, the list goes on and on. Great players. That could have been in the Hall of Fame, but are not going to the Hall of Fame now because they retire so early. Well, except Barry Sanders. He's obviously going to be in there.
Right.
But, and you know what makes this? It makes the Joe Looney signing, one of the most underrated signings in the Cowboys offseason. They were to keep they kept number 73, Looney, out of free agency and signing back with the Cowboys. So Looney's used to being the Cowboys center, and he'll just step right into that role. And Looney's a good center. He's not Travis Frederick. Okay, I'll pump the brakes on that. But Looney's a good center. So now this makes Cowboys be They're probably going to be in the market or in the draft for a center, maybe in the fourth or fifth round, which maybe they wouldn't be. You know, if you've got Travis Frederick and Joe Looney backing him up, those are two very talented centers. Now you only got one. So now you're looking at maybe Cowboys in the fourth or fifth round getting that center.
Yeah, and that has kind of been the staples of the Cowboys for the last, you know, 3 or 4 years was their dominant offensive line. And now it's definitely starting to thin out a little bit. And, you know, we spoke the 2019 season last year just about how the Cowboys starters were all kind of solidified. There was no spots that were open. And now we're starting to see more spots open. And now there's another spot open on the defensive side. Byron Jones leaves for Miami Dolphins. How much does this hurt the Cowboys next year?
We're a little hurt, but there's another one. He signed a 5-year, $81 million deal. I would not have paid Byron Jones that.
Right.
He didn't get – he's a good corner, okay? But he didn't get enough turnovers. You got 2 turnovers in his – how many games for the Cowboys? 80, 90 games or something? You can't – I mean, listen, 5 interceptions have to at least fall in your lap in that many games. And he had 2 interceptions for his entire career. He's a good football player, not taking anything away from him. But I'm not paying him $81 million. He's not $81 million good. So does this hurt the Cowboys? Sure. They re-signed Anthony Brown. Jordan Lewis is good. Chidobe Awuzie is a good football player. We'll be in the market. Cowboys will be in the market in the draft, maybe with that 17th pick for a corner. They signed Ha-Ha Clinton-Dix, who's a pretty good safety. They got Xavier Woods back there. So, yeah, if you're talking holes to fill and stuff like that, sure. Dallas will be in the market. And there's a couple of good free agent corners still out there. Jimmy Smith comes to mind, former first-round pick of the Ravens. Logan Ryan, who intercepted Tom Brady's last pass as a New England Patriot for the Tennessee Titans. He's out there, okay? So I'm trying to figure out where Will McClay and Stephen Jones are going with this, why they wouldn't sign one of those two players. I'd rather have Logan Ryan than Jimmy Smith, but hey, if they sign Jimmy Smith, I'd be happy with it. Maybe they're thinking with the 17th pick, they can get a good player. They can get a corner. Obviously, Jeff Okuda will be up the board. C.J. Henderson could be available, kid out of Florida. But we'll see what happens in this draft. But we'll see how good he does. I need a free safety, but he can cover some people as well. Listen, maybe this is time for Chidobe Awuzie and Jordan Lewis to step up.
Yeah.
And they're going to get their opportunity this year.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely like the Ha-Ha Clinton-Dix signing. I've always kind of secretly been a fan of him for 5 or 6 years. I think he's been in the league.
Yeah.
I've always kind of secretly liked him and hope he does well. But one of the biggest question marks, scratching signings that I see here is injury-prone Sean Lee. The Cowboys signed him, for another 1-year deal, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
Do you think this is just a kind of like, hey, you've been with us for so long, we're going to let you go out on your terms, we're going to sign you just to sign you? Or do you think Sean Lee can actually help this defense out next year?
No, I think Sean Lee can actually help this defense out. I would have re-signed him as well. Listen, Sean Lee's on that load management. He's like your Todd Gurley, but of linebacker. If you can't go this week, all right, you don't have to go. Just give us your input and help Jalen Smith and help Leighton Vander Esch study the game plan. And on the weeks that he can go, Sean Lee can dominate some games still. You know, he's not 40 years old. He's 32 years old.
Right.
I mean, he's not totally over the hill. And what better player? Let's just say Vander Esch taps out or Jalen Smith has to come out. What better player would you want to have run in there other than Sean Lee to take his spot real quick?
True.
You know, he's available. If he's available in games, if he plays 8 or 10 games out of this next coming 16-game season, I'm all for it. They're not paying him like they did in the past. I mean, I think it's a 1-year, $4 million deal, peanuts compared to what he's used to getting paid. And Sean Lee loves the game of football. He's a student of the game. And everybody always likes to poo-poo on Sean Lee, just retire. And listen, if there's a big game coming up and he happens to be healthy and we got to go into Philly and try to win it, I want Sean Lee there. He still can make plays. So I thought it was a decent signing.
Yeah, I'm going to pull out some key words that you said there. Healthy, if if healthy, a big game, yada, yada, yada. One healthy player or unhealthy player comes to mind is Vanderish. He did have neck surgery, believe about 6 months ago, I think it was, right at the end of the season.
Yeah.
Do you think the Cowboys signed Sean Lee because Vanderish may not be ready at the start of the season, or they're worried that he just may not be the player that, you know, they thought he was going to be when they drafted him a couple years ago?
Well, from what I'm hearing, Leighton Vanderish, he even could have played if Dallas made the playoffs. They kept him out as a precautionary measure. His long-term health is more important than the short-term gain. And so the reason he sat out and got the neck surgery is so he could have a long career. And when I mean long career, I'm not talking NBA stuff like, you know, 13 years or something ridiculous.
Right.
A long career in the NFL, if Leighton Vanderish played the next 8 years in the NFL and retired, you know, at 30, 31, then he had a long career. Football, you know this, Michael. You played football for a lot of years. I played football for 7 years, and not at the level you did, but I played. It can take a toll on you. If you play 8 years in the National Football League or 9 years, that's a hell of a career. So, you know, Leighton Vanderish got the neck surgery. He's getting ready for this season, and I think he's good to go week one.
Yeah.
Sean Lee is basically just a fill-in. I think Leighton Vanderish is ready to go, and I think because he sat out and had the surgery, he hopefully will have a long, long career.
Yeah, and hopefully he is hungry to get on that field because the Cowboys definitely need that defensive, you know, stopping power that they kind of lacked this last year.
Mm-hmm.
It's like it seemed like.
Yeah.
So the Dallas Cowboys did go 8-8 last season, missing the playoffs, finishing second in the NFC East. So therefore, they get, you know, a fairly high draft pick, you know, mid first round. Where do you think the Cowboys go in the draft? I know you mentioned cornerback if they don't pick up a free agent, but in your gut, where do you see the Cowboys going in the draft?
Well, this is fun because they filled a lot of needs, and then the best signing I think the Cowboys did was Big Gerald McCoy. Number 93, a former number third overall pick out of Oklahoma.
Yeah.
I've watched Gerald McCoy dominate football games before, and I still think he's got some left in the tank. And so do the Cowboys, because they gave him a three-year, $20 million deal? It wasn't a one-year prove-it-to-me deal. It was a three-year, we're going to put you in our program deal. So Gerald McCoy coming to the Cowboys, that feels a huge hole when Malik Collins left in free agency to the Raiders. And now the Cowboys have two defensive tackles that they didn't have last year. Tyrone Crawford didn't play all last year, and Gerald McCoy, now your two defensive tackles. I think that's an upgrade from last year, and now that puts them in a nice position for this 17th overall pick. Now, I would love for Kinlaw to slide down to 17, Javon Kinlaw, defensive end, defensive tackle out of South Carolina. I think you'd start him at defensive end with the Cowboys, but I don't think he falls that way. Listen, this is a wide receiver draft. I mean, if CeCe Lamb at Oklahoma fell to number 17, God, you got Gallup and Cooper and CeCe Lamb. They lost Randall Cobb in free agency to the Texans. Man, CeCe Lamb with the Cowboys? Wow.
That'd be fun to watch, wouldn't it?
That would be unbelievable. I like Kenneth Murray out of Oklahoma, inside-outside linebacker. He wore number 9 in your Oklahoma program. That guy's a dominator. You talk about getting to the quarterback. I mean, I couldn't imagine Sean Lee, Kenneth Murray, Leighton Vander Esch, and Jalen Smith. Wow. They can go a lot of different directions. The 17th overall pick, I've heard Kidney McKinney out of Alabama, free safety, and there's still Grant Delpit, safety out of LSU. They could be in play there for the 17th pick. But, man, this is sky's the limit for Dallas. They have a lot of talent, and usually teams with a lot of talent are picking 27, 28, like the Chiefs, 32, Green Bay's picking 30th,
mm-hmm.
But the Cowboys are picking 17th. That's pretty high up there. I've got them taking Yetur Gross-Matos, number 99 in your Penn State program. Not quite as dominator as Derek Brown and Kinlaw, but man, he can wreck games. And this kid's a heck of a defensive end. And you put him on the opposite side of DeMarcus Lawrence, sky's the limit for the Cowboys defense. They can go a number of directions. This is a wide receiver draft. I mean, if they draft one of these wide receivers, they'll be really explosive. I don't think they will. I think Kuiper's got CeCe Lamb. I just don't see it because you just invested Amari Cooper $100 million, and you're going to have Gallup coming up soon wanting a new contract. And let me tell you something. Michael Gallup might be as good as any of these receivers in this draft.
Yeah.
There are some scouts on other teams that think Michael Gallup could be a number one. And Amari Cooper thinks Michael Gallup could be a number one. So why would you invest your 17th overall pick in another receiver, right? In other words, you don't have to go in that direction. You've got Amari Cooper and Michael Gallup in your program. Even though you lost Randall Cobb, so what? You find another slot receiver somewhere off the free agent wire. I don't think you have to invest, another a lot of money in your 17th overall pick to a wide receiver when you've got two deadly wide receivers. So I'm going in a different direction here. Clavon Chaisson, outside linebacker, LSU. Kenneth Murray, outside inside linebacker, Oklahoma. But I got Yetur Gross-Matos, number 99 for Penn State. I watched that kid wreck games, and he is the perfect kind of kid. He just gets it done. There's no flamboyancy with him. He just comes to work every day. Gross-Matos out of Penn State, and he just comes to work every day, and he gets it done like a DeMarcus Lawrence. You basically would be putting another DeMarcus Lawrence on the opposite of DeMarcus Lawrence in Gross-Matos out of Penn State.
That would be definitely nice for Cowboys fans and definitely not so nice for Giants, Eagles, and Redskins fans and whoever else they get to play in the 2020 season. But we're getting short on time here, but I overlooked one big free agent signing, or re-signing, I should say. I want you to flash back to 2018 season. How did the Rams beat the Cowboys? They beat the Cowboys because the Cowboys could not convert on third down. They didn't have a tight end to really convert that third down conversion. So last year, Jason Witten came back, and we thought he was going to be the savior. And he had a decent year for being older, But they signed Blake Jarwin to a 4-year, $22 million deal. He is a tight end. However, that they are saying that this does not close the door for Jason Witten's comeback. Is this a good signing for the Dallas Cowboys?
Absolutely. I've always liked Blake Jarwin. Yeah, I don't think he's ever going to be in that upper echelon tight end, but he's one of those like an Andy Dalton at quarterback. That's what Blake Jarwin is at tight end. He's going to get the job done for you. He can go vertical downfield and catch long passes. He can block a little bit. And this is another thing. People love to always – Cowboy fans, I don't know where you're getting this from. People love to always – I can see why you poo-poo on Jeff Heath sometimes, but Blake Jarwin is a good tight end, and I think that the fans will come to appreciate him. Once they don't see Witten in there, Jason Witten, first ballot Hall of Famer, but once they see Blake Jarwin in there all the time and he catching passes downfield, I think Cowboy fans will learn to appreciate him more and more. There's a reason why Dallas signed him and put him in the program for a long time. Will McClay's no dummy. He believes in Blake Jarwin, and so do I.
Yeah, it is kind of surprising for me for the 4-year, $22 million deal.
Yeah.
Is because we did not see him a lot on the field. I believe he played less than 40% of the snaps in the 2019 season. So we don't really know what he's capable of for us casual fans that, catch a Cowboys game here or there.
Real quick, Michael, when Dallas was deadly and they were moving the football, they moved the football a lot, by the way. They just didn't score enough touchdowns.
Right.
They moved between the 10s and the 20s a lot. When they went 12 personnel and they had Witten and Jarwin in at the same time. So Jarwin's a heck of a player. But, yeah, you know what? They're still in the market for some more tight ends. I wouldn't rule that out in the draft either, drafting a good tight end.
All right, guys, that's going to be it for today. Thank you for joining us. Marcus, thank you for joining me as always. He is going to be our Cowboys guy here moving forward, guys. So definitely check out Marcus the Freak on Twitter. Follow him and whatnot. He puts out good content there, guys. So have a good day. We'll catch you next time. Just for Clicks, Monday through Friday, noon East Coast time, rtssportsnetwork.com.